Everyone, 1 minute before I start the lecture, first I'm sorry for the delay. Sometimes everything goes wrong, what can you do? And I see that many people came, especially for the event that we plan tonight. And as Danny just said before me, it's very important for each one of us, at least after this lecture, to accept one mitzvah. When a person is not feeling well, is sick, you can sit and read for him Tehillim, which is a mitzvah. But it will be much more productive if everybody tonight will accept one mitzvah that he doesn't do. Somebody can give tzedakah, somebody would put tefillin, somebody, you know, everyone will do something, whatever you can. And because of that, Hashem, God is giving life. He's giving health. Everything is in His hand. When he sees so many Jews, Baruch Hashem came here tonight just for this mitzvah, first of all, it's a very big thing. And when HaKadosh Baruch Hu is satisfied with what Jews do one for another, things can change and become better, Bezrat Hashem. And that's, by the way, the reason I'm here. We're going to give a lecture that will be very interesting. The important is to pay attention to every word, because you probably will never see a lecture like this anywhere else you go. Usually when you go, you listen to words of Torah, they're already teaching you Torah from the Torah. But many people here, they maybe have doubts about some of the things that the Torah says, which because of the doubts, they don't keep. For instance, I've been speaking for about 14 years everywhere. I go in America, all over, in Israel. And Baruch Hashem, on the website, there's thousands of people, thousands every week goes and listen to lectures in different countries, even Goyim. Goyim become Jews. Every day I get 5 to 10 text messages and email from non-Jews begging to become Jewish. White, black, Pakistanis, Indian, Arab from Egypt, hundreds of Christians. Why? They're all foolish? The answer is no. Until the day they saw the website, they didn't know what God is all about. Everybody has his own belief. One, they begin to see the lecture, especially this lecture that I'm going to show you now. They realize that the Jewish Torah is the only book that God gave people. No other book, no Quran, no New Testament, none of it. Anybody who is interested, after the lecture, I have three DVDs I can give you. It's a three-hour session, 1 hour each, 3 times 1 hour, all together 3 hours. It's in English. You can watch it on your DVD. If anybody ever had doubts about the Torah, if it's from God or not, after tonight you will never have any more doubts at all. Not only the written Torah that you see in the synagogue, the oral Torah that went from generation to generation, the rabbi passed it one to another, everything we received in Mount Sinai from Hashem, from the creator of the world. Once you know that the book that you see in synagogue or that you read in it is really the word of God, it's much easier to listen to it. If you think the rabbis made it up, it's very difficult to keep it. Why should I listen to them? I'm a person, they are people. Why should I listen to them? With all the respect. But if my creator gave me these rules, these laws, why should I go against him? I can only lose. So it's all about one thing. Can I prove scientifically that God gave us the Torah or not? If I do, the rest is your free choice. Do whatever you want with this. It's your choice. But if you're not convinced 100%, even if you convince 80%, it's not enough to do. Because you're always going to have doubts. But this lecture removes any doubts that you have. You're going to know now 100% that from the next time you look at the Torah, you know this Torah was given to us by the creator of the world. Who is the creator of the world? The one who gives us oxygen to breathe. The one who gives us water to drink, food to eat, house to live, a car to drive, a suit to wear. Everything we have comes from Him. And He gave us the Torah, the Jews, 3,320 years ago. Millions of Jews, between 10 to 15 million Jews that came out of Egypt, after 210 years that we were slaves in Egypt. Egypt was the biggest empire in the world. And after 210 years that we were slaves in Egypt, we came out. Before we came out, as we read in the Torah, there was 1 year that God took revenge against the Goyim that made us suffer so much. As we all know, we read it in Pesach night, in the Haggadah, Dam, Tzfardea, Kinim, Arov, all these plagues that HaKadosh Baruch Hu did to the Goyim. After 1 year, we came out. We came out on Pesach, Passover. And we received the Torah exactly 7 weeks later, 49 days later, after we came out, we received the Torah in front of millions of people. Now, what's the difference between Jews and all the other Goyim? There's many differences, but what's the main difference? After the Jews received the Torah, the Goyim also wanted to have a book. So the Goyim started to invent religions and cults one after the other. How many times the Goyim made up a religion after the Jews received the Torah? 80,000 times. From the minute the Jews received the Torah and the whole world was shocked that finally God came and spoke to millions of people, the Hebrews, the Jews, all the Goyim translated the Torah to 70 languages right away. To all the languages in the world. All the Goyim admired the Jews. Muhammad called us Am HaSefer, the nation of the book. In the Quran, in every chapter, it mentioned the Torah. It mentioned Musa, Moshe. It mentioned Miriam. It mentioned Aaron. It mentioned the nation of Israel. It mentioned Yaakov, Yosef. All these names from the Torah mentioned in the Quran. Same thing in the New Testament. All the things that happened to the Jews are mentioned in their religion. The Christians and the Muslims never tried to say that the Jews didn't receive the Torah from God. The opposite. They say, no question. The Jews received the book from Allah or from God or from Hashem. It doesn't matter. The difference is that they claim since the Jews didn't listen to God enough, God left them alone and chose us instead. And He gave us another book. What is it? The New Testament or the Quran. They don't tell the people that the Torah already promised that no matter what the Jews are going to do, no matter how ungrateful they can be and stay against God, He can never leave the Jews ever. Why? Because He swore to Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov that He will never replace their children with any other nation. Even though He will punish the Jews, and we suffer more than any other nation in the world, the history shows, many pogroms, many holocausts, many problems. We were in the exile for 2,000 years until we returned to Israel. All the suffering, the Torah said. But the Torah promised God never replaced the Jews with any other nation. Now, what's the difference between the Torah and all the other religions and cults? Every time somebody came and say God gave him something, like Muhammad, he came and said that angel Gabriel gave him the Quran in the desert. How many witnesses this Goyim brought with them? Nothing. Not once in the history, one of these Goyim brought witnesses to say, I saw the angel give Muhammad the Quran. I saw Mary becoming pregnant from God, and JC was born from her. Nobody ever witnessed that event. Why? When a woman has a dream that God came to her and made her pregnant, how many witnesses she can bring to her dream? Nobody. Even she is not a witness, because in a dream sometimes you don't remember 100%, especially in a dream like this. So anyway, nobody ever witnessed her story. Nobody ever saw that Muhammad spoke to the angel. It's 50-50 right away. 50% doubt right away. When you begin to read the Quran, Buddhism, Christianity, you find so many mistakes inside the book that you see right away. God never gave this baloney, nothing. Why? There's so many mistakes that when you begin to read it, you see that the one who wrote the Quran and the one who wrote the New Testament was somebody in the level of kindergarten. I give you two examples what I mean. The Quran say that Paro and Haman had a meeting and they were thinking how to stop the Jews. Paro and Haman lived 1,000 years after Paro died. But the one who wrote the Quran, he was copying from the Torah and from the Tanakh, and he didn't know the dates correctly. So he decided to make a story. Haman and Paro sitting and eating Gondi together. Something like this can only happen in a dream. And this is in the Quran. And there's many, many other foolish mistakes that right away you see God never gave this. God doesn't make such foolish mistakes. In the New Testament, it's much worse. Every chapter full of mistakes. Full of mistakes. For instance, they say, they try to prove that Joseph the carpenter, which is the husband of Miriam, Mary and Yosef, is two Jews. They get engaged, he goes away, he comes back after a few months, he sees she's pregnant. What did you do? She said, nothing. God came to me in a dream and I'm pregnant and the boy will be the Mashiach. So, how many witnesses? Nobody saw. Now when you begin to read inside the New Testament, in the first chapter, they're trying to link Joseph to who? To King David. They're trying to show that Joseph the carpenter is a grandson of David HaMelech. Why they care about David HaMelech so much? Because in our Torah it says Mashiach ben David. Mashiach must be from the family of David HaMelech. Must be. He can be a very righteous Jew, but he's not the grandson of David HaMelech. He cannot be Mashiach. So they're trying to make JC the son of David HaMelech to prove that he's Mashiach. After they finish all the generations, supposedly, they begin to tell a story that he went out of town. And when he came back, he saw that his fiance is pregnant. And inside the story, they admit that Joseph is not the father. Why are you such a fool? Why are you wasting a page and a half to show that Joseph is the grandson of David HaMelech when in the next page you write that you admit that he's not the father? And it's full of stupid mistakes, one after the other. For instance, he said, I'm skipping a lot from this lecture because we don't have time, so I'm telling you everything in 5 minutes, but usually it takes me half an hour to show on the screen all the mistakes in the Quran. If you want to see it, I'll give you the DVD and you can watch it at home. But there's many other mistakes. In the Torah it says that Jacob went to Egypt with 70 people. In the New Testament, it became 75. What happened to God? He forgot how many Jews came to Egypt? All of a sudden it became 75? And they admit that the Torah is the word of God. If there is an Old Testament, which is the Torah, and there is a New Testament, it has to comply together. Cannot be one the opposite of the other. It's from the same God. Many mistakes, one after the other. But in our Torah, nobody ever found one mistake. 3,320 years. Not only that nobody found a mistake, I want you to pay attention very carefully to what I'm going to tell you in the next 3 minutes. Please don't lose me, because it's very important. When you come to a bunch of Jews, 1,000, 10,000, 100,000, it doesn't matter. You take non-religious Jews, Jews who don't keep Shabbat, they don't eat kosher, they don't put tefillin, they don't give tzedakah, they're not modest. They make all the sins you can think of, every day, like this, all their life. One day, a person comes with a book, and he goes like this. Excuse me, ladies and gentlemen, I want to tell you something. What do you want to tell us? God gave me this book to give you. Why God gave us a book? The book, Torah in Hebrew, means instructions. God gave us a book to tell us what to do and what not to do. And the book say, if you listen to me and follow my rules, after your soul comes out of the body, what we call after you die, I take the soul to heaven and I pay the soul the best spiritual pleasure you can think of forever and ever. It will never stop. For billions of years. If you pass my test. And if you don't care about my book, I will punish you severely for what you did. One way or the other, it's up to you. You have 100% free choice to listen to me or to ignore me. To go with me or to go against me. 100% free choice. You're not an animal. You don't live by instinct. You can choose to do good, you can choose to do bad. And based on what you choose, I'm going to pay you your reward, or chas v'shalom, I'll punish you. This is the book I'm giving you. Now the people are not interested to change their lifestyle. They like to do shish kebab on Shabbat. They like to watch television on Shabbat. They like to smoke. They like to eat mat kosher. They like to go to all kinds of shows. They don't want to live like this book. So they begin to demonstrate. Leave us alone. We're not interested. But the history shows that close to 15 million Jews became very religious overnight. Today, they were like goyim. Tomorrow, everybody was religious. Until 200 years ago, it was almost impossible to find Jews that are not religious. Until Moshe Mendelssohn in Europe, almost all over the world, every Jew you saw had a yarmulke and a beard, and the women were covered with their head. I show you black and white picture. All your grandmothers and their mothers and their mothers in Iran, all of them were religious for more than 2,000 years. From the time of Mordechai and Esther, all the Jews all over the world were religious, some more, some less. But nobody said the Torah is not the word of God. Everybody knew. There were synagogues everywhere, Torah everywhere, the rabbi was the head of the community. That's how it was. How all the Jews agree all of a sudden to become religious? What happened in history that all of a sudden, overnight, everybody became religious? Not only that, when Moshe brought the Torah to the Jews and they opened up the Torah speaks about who? Who does the Torah speak about? About these millions of Jews that are receiving the Torah. I come to give you a book. Here is the book. Take it. Read it. You open up the book and you begin to read about yourself. That few months ago you were a slave in Egypt. True or false? If it wasn't true, nobody would agree to accept it. What kind of book is this from God that it says that I was in Egypt a slave? I never been in Egypt. It's a lie. I never been a slave. I never saw everything in Egypt became blood. I never saw millions of frogs in Egypt. I didn't see every Egyptian died. I didn't see. I didn't see we going through the ocean and all the goyim are drowning. I don't see bread falling from heaven. Remember, if I find one mistake in the Torah, what do I do? Excuse me, Moshe. You came to fool us? You just gave us this book. You say that God gave you the book to give us. But everything I read in this book never happened to me. If one of the things that the Torah say did not happen 100%, you know what would happen to Moshe Rabbeinu? They make him shish kebab on a grill. In 1 minute he would be dead. Why? People don't use their head. That's why a lot of people have doubts. But if you use your head, in 10 minutes it's 100% clear. Many of the Jews, when they open up the Torah, they started to cry. Why? God just spoke to them. Why you cry? You should be very happy. You know why they cried? Because they married their aunts. He married his father's sister. It was perfectly fine. It was allowed. Until today we marry cousins. But before the Torah was given to the Jews, Jews used to marry their aunt, their father's sister. Why not? They all live together in the same area. As soon as they open up the Torah, they begin to cry. Wow, I have to get divorced. I cannot be with my wife anymore. I have 10 children. There was no birth control yet. 10, 15, 17 children. Some had more than one wife. Some people have 20, 30 children. He just found out that he can never touch his wife's hand. Finish. She's not his wife anymore. Why? Until now he was fine. And now it became illegal. Thousands of Jews started to scream, "What did you do to us? We don't want this." The next problem, they prepared thousands of cows to eat on holiday. It was Shavuot holiday. When they opened up the Torah, they just found out all the cows have to go to the garbage. It's not kosher. They killed it with regular knife. They didn't slaughter the throat. They didn't check the knife. They didn't check the animal. It's not glad kosher. Everything has to go to the garbage. There was no Arabs yet to give them the leftover halal meat. There was no Islam yet. It's 2,000 years before Islam. All the cows, remember, this is 15 million people. To feed 15 million people, you need tens of thousands of cows and goats. Tens of thousands of cows in today's time, each cow is $5,000 today. Tens of thousands, we're talking hundreds, tens or hundreds of millions of dollars has to go right away to the garbage. Now Jews, when they find out they have to throw millions of dollars to the garbage, they're not so happy about this. So first they found out they have to get divorced. Not only that, now he has to take all the cows and throw to the garbage. Third, they found out they cannot smoke in Shabbat anymore. They cannot write. They cannot cook. There was no refrigerator, no timer, no Shabbos clock. None of these things that we have today, they had. What was the chances that these Jews will agree to become religious and take the book? Close to zero. Nobody would agree. If somebody brings you a book, it comes from out of nowhere. Excuse me, everyone, here is the book, God gave it to me. And you just found out that this book is your biggest enemy. It's going to destroy you. So what is the first thing you're going to do? You're going to fight against the book and against the prophet. Why? The prophet is going to ruin your life. Not only they didn't fight against the prophet, they all say, no problem, everything you say will do. When they open up the book said that God spoke to Moshe and all the nation of Israel heard the voice of God saying, the first two commandments, I'm your God that took you out of Egypt, you should not have any other God but me. When he came to say the third commandment, all the Jews started to scream. The third commandment is you should not swear in the name of God on a false testimony. When God was about to read the third commandment, the Jews started to scream. And Moshe said, why are you all getting nervous? And they said, no, we cannot take this. It's too scary. The floor is shaking. There's a huge siren, the noise of a shofar. Fire all over the mountain. Fog everywhere, and hear the voice of God coming from the mountain. It's very scary, early in the morning. And the Jews couldn't take it. So Moshe said, relax, God didn't bring us to the mountain to kill us. It's all a test. He's giving us this Torah to see if we are faithful to Him, if we are grateful to Him, or we're going to ignore His mitzvot. It's all a test. Everything I just told you appear in the Torah in Parashat Yitro. How do I know it really happened? Maybe somebody fooled us. Maybe somebody has a great imagination and he made up this whole story and it never happened. How do I know for sure it happened? Very simple. When the Jews receive the Torah, they are interested to get rid of it. All they have to do is find one mistake. Now when I open the Torah, and I know I must find a mistake. Because if I don't find a mistake, then it's really from God. I have to get divorced. I have to take the meat and throw it to the garbage. But if I find one mistake, I point at Moshe and say, you're lying. God never gave you this book. It's full of mistakes. When I read in the book that I heard the voice of God speaking to this person called Moshe, I heard. Who knows better than me if I heard the voice of God or not? I know if I heard the voice of God, no? So the Torah says, all of you heard the voice of God speaking to Moshe. And everybody say, right, we heard. It was enough that one Jew
did not hear the voice of God and raise his hand and say, excuse me, sir, I did not hear God speaking to you. They say they did, but I didn't. One Jew out of 15 millions would say that he did not hear the voice of God, that would be the end of the Torah right there. Why? Because the Torah say the entire nation of Israel hearing the voice of God. The entire nation. That means one Jew didn't hear, it's finished right away. Now, let's see what's going on today in the world. As you can see right here on the screen, that's not enough room here. Usually I have a bigger screen. Let's try to manage what we have. The Christians are close to 2 billion. One-third of the world. Muslims, 19%. By tomorrow, it's going to be 20%. Hindus, 13%. Buddhists, 5%. You think 5%? It's nothing. It's hundreds of millions of people, 5%. Jews, 0.025%. Take 1% of the world, divided to 40, 1% of the whole world, divided to 40 pieces, take one piece out, 13.2 million Jews all over the world. Do you have any nation that is more famous than the Jews all over the world? Everywhere you go, the Jews are always the subject of everything. Economy, politics, Torah, science, medicine. Give you an example. In United States, there's a lot of doctors and lawyers, right? The Jews in United States are 6 million, approximately. 6 million. 6 million from 300 million is not a lot. It's nothing. 2% from the community. How many doctors you have in United States? 50% of the doctors in United States are Jewish. 50% are Goyim. 294 million Goyim and 6 million Jews contributed the same amount of doctors and lawyers and judges to society. Now, in business, in science, in medicine, always look at the list of all the inventions. More than half of it is Jewish names. The Torah promised that God said to the Jews, I'm going to spread you in all the nations. And only very few of you will survive because you are not listening to my Torah. But when you're going to be by the Goyim in the Gentiles, everybody is going to talk about you. Ve'ayita sham lemashal ulishnina. Now let's see what's going on here. God is sending Moshe to save the Jews out of Egypt. Moshe said to God, I don't want to go. God said, why? He said, I'm stuttering. He's stuttering. I cannot talk. God answered him, who made your mouth? I made your mouth. Don't worry, I'll put the right words in your mouth. Then Moshe came with another excuse. My brother Aaron is 3 years older than me. He's going to get offended. Send him. Hashem said, I know the heart of your brother Aaron is pure, pure. He's not going to get offended. 1 week, Moshe doesn't want to go. In the end of the argument, when God began, we're becoming angry at him, Moshe says, I don't want to go because anyway they won't listen to me. They think I'm a fool. If you come to millions of slaves and say, God sent me to save you, what are they going to say? Go find your mother somewhere, leave us alone. What are you coming to drive us crazy? We're walking here, leave us alone. You don't have proof that God spoke to you. So Moshe said, they won't believe me. So God said, don't worry. They're right. Why should they believe you? You're going to bring them to the mountain, and I am going to speak to you in front of everyone. And after they hear that I'm speaking to you, and I nominate you to be the prophet, they will believe in you for eternity. Which means that God say to him, if they don't believe you, they are right. Why should they believe you? Everybody that come and say, God spoke to me, you have to believe him? Do you have a proof or not? Did Muhammad have a proof? Never. Did Mary have a proof? Never. Buddha that came, he said that he saw the light. Did he have a proof? Never. 80,000 times when people came and say, God spoke to me, or the angel spoke to me, did they have a proof? Never. When Moshe brought the Torah, did he have the proof? Hundreds of proofs. Everybody here that God spoke to him. That's the beginning of Judaism compared to all the other religions. Now listen to this. Now I'm going to prove to you that the Torah could never be written by a human being. No human being, even the smartest person in history, even you take the top million smarter people ever live, give them computer, give them satellite, give them anything you want, give them 100 years to see it, they cannot write one page in the Torah. Why? If you bring me a Sefer Torah, I make a deal with you. Every page you open, I show you in that chapter many prophecies to the future. What's going to happen in 1,000 years? In 2,000 years? In 3,000 years? How a person knows what's going to happen tomorrow? Anybody knows what's going to happen an hour from now? Nobody knows. Nobody knows the future. You can be a very smart person, but you don't know what's going to happen in 100 years. You don't know. If you write in the Torah what's going to happen 2,000 years from now, and 2,000 years you see that everything happened, you know a person couldn't write such a book. I'll give you an example. The Torah says, I'm going to translate right away. Go, this is applying to every Jew in history. Every Jew, even to us. Because the Torah, when God gave us the Torah says, for you and your children after you for eternity. Ledorotechem. Until the end of the world. When we open the Torah today, it applies to us exactly like it applied to the generation of Moshe. Same thing. When we read this, we cannot be foolish and ignore it. This is what the Torah says. Every Jew, dear Jew, go check in a history. Go check in a history. No, check what? Did you ever hear about a group of Gentiles, group of Goyim, that claim that I spoke to them or gave them a book? Go and check. A group. The highlight on the word group, more than one. Did you ever hear that me, God, spoke to a group of non-Jews and gave them a book or anything? Did you ever hear that I made a miracle to a group of Gentiles with magics and strong arm and a war like I did to you in Egypt? Go and check. The Torah already promised that it's true that it's going to be many, many fakers, many false prophets that claim that God gave them something. But God already promised in the Torah, I will make sure that it's always going to be one person, never a group of people. Now try to think for 1 minute. If Muhammad would bring 5 of his cousins and give each one of them $1,000 bribe, Mustafa, Ahmed, Mahmoud, Ahmadi, you're all my cousin. Here is $1,000 cash to each one of you. I want you to learn this story by heart. Tomorrow at 2 o'clock, I want all of you to come. I'm going to tell the people that the angel gave me the Quran, and all of you have to swear that you saw the angel giving me the Quran. That's all. Nothing else. I don't need anything from you. You saw the angel is coming. He's putting the Quran in my hand. And you go. Here is your money. 1,000, 10,000, whatever you want. No problem. If something like this would happen, even though we know he's a liar, because the Quran is full of mistakes, we would have a very big problem in Judaism. Why? Because the Torah promised, No group of goyim will ever claim that me, God, communicated with them in any way. It's always gonna be one person, not two, not four, not ten. 80,000 times a goy came and made up a lie. Not once he brought one or two witnesses to say that he's right. The Torah promised it will never happen. It's enough that after 80,000 times, one nation would have in the record that they started their religion in front of two, three, ten witnesses, the Torah, Chas v'Shalom, will go into the toilet. Why? Because it will have the first mistake. Once the book have mistake, it's not from God. God doesn't make mistakes. If God say, I will never speak to a group of goyim, and a bunch of Saudi Arabs will have in their family a book that God spoke to five of them, that will be the first lie in the Torah. And it never happened in 3,320 years. That's the first proof. Let's see the second proof. I'm skipping some. Some of it I already said.
Yeah.
Okay, let's see the first proof. Now remember, when we received the Torah, we didn't only receive the written scroll that you see in the synagogue. We received the written Torah and the oral Torah. You cannot make one mitzvah in the written Torah without learning what the oral Torah has to say about it. I'll give you an example. How many mitzvot we have in the Torah? Who knows? 613. Why God chose such a weird number? He couldn't make it 600 even? 700 even? 500 even? Why he had to make 613? The body of the person has 613 different parts. 248 organs, 365 ligaments. Together, 613. That's the human body. The Torah, 248 positive mitzvot, 365 restriction. You should not kill, you should not steal, you should not speak bad about your brother. Each you should not, 365 you should not, each you should not connect to one ligament. 365 ligament, 365 restriction. Each time the Torah says you should do, you should put tefillin on your hand. You should put tefillin on your head. It's two different mitzvot. You should eat matzah on Pesach. You should sit in a sukkah and sukkot. Every obligation that God says to the Jews in the Torah, each you should do, connect to one organ in a body. 613, 613. When the soul comes out of the body, when a person dies, what happened to the soul? The soul is the same person without the physical body. The soul is exactly the same person. He hears, he sees, he remembers, he's functioning, everything the same without the physical body. No body, but the soul is exactly the same. The soul already been in the world few times in different bodies. Today your name is Yosef. 80 years ago, your name was Yitzchak, in a different country, in a different language. The scientists, the parapsychologists, are proving today reincarnations. Why? They hypnotize people. It's called regression. They take you back in history. If you are 50 years old today, they put you to sleep. They tell you, I want you to look at the wall for 5 minutes, don't move. And relax. Just relax. He's talking to your head. Relax, relax, relax. After 5-10 minutes, he begins to talk to your subconscious. What does it mean, subconscious? It's direct communication with your storage, with your soul. All the information you saw in all your lives, in different bodies, in different places, in different languages, are all stored inside your soul. And now he says, I want you to go with me to 1980. It's August 12, 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Tell me where you are right now. Live. He begins to talk and he describes that he's in Tehran somewhere and he's about to go to the market to sell diamonds. And you talk to him live. It's 38 years ago. 28 years ago. 1980. Now he's 50. Now you hear from his mouth a person like 22 years old, because that's what he is right now. Then you say, let's go back to 1970, 1960. Then you see a 50 years old man crawl on the carpet and make noises like baby from his mouth. Real baby, 1 year old, crying. He wants to drink water. He's crawling on the floor, 50 years old. Male, female, it doesn't matter. Then you say, let's go to 1940. But he wasn't born yet. Sometimes you hear silence. He doesn't make a beep. He paused. Then you say, let's go to 1930. No answer. 1920. He doesn't answer. 1910, all of a sudden, he begins to talk in a different language. For instance, maybe you don't know French, but if we hypnotize you and we go to 1910, all of a sudden, we may see you now speaking in French or in Germany or in Arabic. Later, when the parapsychologist will bring you back to conscious, he's going to show you a video of yourself speaking in a language that you don't understand. You ask the interpreter, what am I saying? I don't understand. How am I talking French or Arabic? The answer is, this is what you used to be in your previous life. Now he can tell you what's your name was, who was your wife, how many children you have, how did you die? Everything you can find out through hypnosis. For instance, they took one very fat person, 400 pounds, he cannot move, all day he's eating. They took him to treat him by hypnosis. And guess what they found? That he was on a boat in the middle of the ocean. The boat hit a huge piece of ice. There was a hole in the bottom of the boat. They had flowers, bags of flowers, rice on the boat. Everything got wet, spread all over with the water, and he starved to death in the middle of the ocean. This psychological problem of dying from starvation stayed in the subconscious of the soul. Even though the soul was transferred to a new body, the person has a mental problem that is in a fear that he must eat. Why? Because he died from starvation. This is how they treat. That's explained why some ladies cannot communicate with a man and why certain people are afraid when they hear airplanes. They checked an Italian woman. Every time there were airplanes, she jumped under the chair and hiding. They don't understand. When they hypnotized her, they found out, actually she was Brazilian. They found out that in her previous life, now she's speaking in Italian, she was in a world war. And she lived in a place where planes were bombing. And she has fear from planes. But this is now in a new body. So this is to explain you how it works. Now, when the beginning of the Torah, we don't need them to tell us how the body is. The Torah say God created Adam, sand from the ground. And he blew into his nostrils a divine soul. And Adam became a living creature. He started to move and talk. How does a person die, the Torah says, and the soul will exit the body and return to the master, because he is the one who gave it, and the body will return to the ground, because that's where it was taken from. This is life and death according to the Torah. Now, when God gave us the Torah, it was the written Torah and the oral Torah. For instance, without the oral Torah, you wouldn't know how to circumcise the baby. The Torah didn't say where to cut. All the Torah say, you have to circumcise every male born in the 8th day, and it's a covenant between me and you forever in the body. That's all. Where is Orla? The Torah say to cut the Orla. Nobody knew. The Torah didn't say where to cut. If Moshe would come down from the mountain and give them the Torah, and they open up the Torah and they said they have to cut something in their babies in the 8 days, nobody would know where to cut. The Torah didn't say which tool to use. What happened if the baby is yellow? What happened if his brother was circumcised and he died? Are you allowed to do to another? Maybe it's generic, maybe it's in the genes. The Torah didn't say in a day or in the night. The Torah didn't say all this. The Torah only said to do a circumcision in the 8 day. How to do? The Torah never said. No instruction in the entire Torah how to do Brit Milah. How to keep Shabbat? The Torah says you should not create any melacha on the 7 days. It's a holy day. It's a covenant between me and you. Which restriction you're not allowed or you're allowed to do, the Torah never said. The Torah says you have to put a sign on your hand. The Torah didn't say what sign. The Torah didn't say tefillin. The Torah didn't say that it's black. The Torah didn't say that in one side it has shin with 3 and on the other side it has shin with 4. The Torah didn't say from which animal. The Torah didn't say the size of the tefillin. The Torah didn't say what to put inside. Which parts of the Torah to write inside. With what ink to use. What ingredients to cook and to make the ink. What happens if you miss a letter? There is more than 1,000 instructions how to make tefillin. 1 year it takes to make tefillin. It's not an easy thing. One instruction you did incorrect, it's nothing. It's a piece of stone on the street. Nothing. It doesn't worth a dollar. You bury it in the ground. 1 year they work. One letter accidentally touched the other, it's not divine anymore. It's a mistake. That's not what God said. We cannot move an inch from what God told us. Now, where is it in the written Torah? The Christians, when I had the debate with the Christian priest, he was arguing with me, you're bringing to me proofs from the oral Torah, but I don't believe in the oral Torah. So I told him, if God gave us 613 mitzvot, some of them have strict punishment. Some of the punishment, God forbid, is execution. Some of the punishment say that the soul will never enter the world to come because of certain sins. Is it possible that God will give us such punishment and He will never tell us anywhere in Torah how to do the mitzvot? So what's the point of giving us Torah if we don't know how to keep the mitzvot? Now, when you read inside the text, the Torah said, these are the Torahs, plural, the Torahs with S, that I put in the hand of Moshe in Mount Sinai, the written Torah and the oral Torah. If you're still not sure, inside the Torah, God said to Moshe how to do a sacrifice. But God doesn't tell him how to do it. What does He tell him? As I showed you in the mountain. It says in the text. As I showed you a movie in a mountain, how to do. How to cut it to pieces, what to do, what not to do. The Torah doesn't say how to do it. The Torah said to Moshe, as I showed you in the mountain. Which we see that a lot of the information, it's not in the book. Now pay attention to this, please. This is a part from the written Torah, and this is from the oral Torah. The Torah says, every Jew has to eat kosher fish. Shark is not kosher. Shrimps is not kosher. Tuna, it's kosher. Salmon is kosher. How do we know? The Torah didn't say the names of this fish. You don't find the word tuna inside the Torah. You don't find the word shrimps inside the Torah. How do we know which fish is kosher, which fish is not kosher? The answer is, the Torah says, everything that God did needs two witnesses. If you have two witnesses, it's kosher. The Torah says, This is what you have to eat from everything that lives in the water. Everything that has fins and scales, you can eat. What does it mean, this? The Torah didn't say fish. Everything that lives in water, you are allowed to eat if it has fins and scales. If it has those two, it's kosher. If it doesn't have it, or even one of them, it's not kosher. Which water the Torah spoke about? All the water in the world. He didn't say the Atlantic Ocean, the Middle East. He didn't say. All over the world. From the entire world, how much of the world is water? 72% of the world is water. 3/4 of the world is water. How deep? How deep? 12 kilometers, 8 miles, from here to Queens. From here to Main Street, Queens, that's how deep they reach so far. It's much, much deeper. But this is what we already know that for sure that we have. 8 miles depth. Now, it's very interesting. We know more than 40,000 different kind of fish today in the archives. We go into the oral Torah, the oral law, and this is what the oral law, and this is a proof that the Torah is 100% divine. No person was able to write such a thing. Only the creator of the world was able to say those 7 words. What is it? Everything that has scales has fins. Guarantee. God comes to the nation of Israel and say, dear Jew, you want to know if it's kosher or not? No problem. You just caught a fish. Here, we just caught it. We never saw it before. First time in history. We scratch the body of the fish, we see scales are falling down. We see the fish has fins, kosher, we can eat. Comes the oral Torah and say, I want to teach you a secret. What is the secret? If you see half of the fish, only the head, half, somebody cut it. You don't see the back, only the front. And you see scales in the body, but you don't see the fins in the back, you don't see. Somebody cut it. You see in the market, half a fish. You see scales on the fish, it's kosher. But you don't see the fins. God said, everything that I made with fins, I also put, everything that I made with scales, I put fins in the same body. Guaranteed, don't worry. So if you see scales, for sure you have fins. Now, to write such a thing, you have to watch the entire ocean simultaneously and see billions of things moving inside the water. Sharks, turtles, fish, everything that moves inside the water, you have to see. If there is one thing that has scales and doesn't have fins, it's the end of the Torah. The end of Judaism, the end of Yom Kippur, the end of Shabbat, the end of marriage, the end of the Torah, the end of mezuzah, the end of holidays, the end of everything. Why? Somebody found a fish with scales that doesn't have fins. First mistake in the Torah, chas v'shalom. Which means, if you have one snake in the oceans that have scales, snakes has a tail, doesn't have fins. If you find one snake with scales, that you scratch and the scales are falling, the Torah is over, finished, no more Judaism. What's the connection? God promised that you will never find such a thing. And here we are, we found. That's the first mistake. First mistake, no more tefillin, do whatever you want. Marry Christine tomorrow, no problem. Why? How can I trust the Torah? It's a mistake. It gets even better. When the Torah was given to us, everybody hear me in the back, I scream as much as I can. When the Torah was given to us 3,320 years ago, half of the things that lives in the ocean were not even exist. Every month, we have new species created. Automatically, they mix, and they create new species all the time. Scientists are making in aquariums and in pools all the time new species. If they will make one time something that has scales and doesn't have fins, that will be the end of the Torah. What human being 3,300 years ago was able to write such a thing? And you know what's the best thing? That right next to it, it says, you must keep my Shabbos. Do not create any fire on the seventh day. Have to make sure you have tefillin on your heart and on your brain every day. Eat kosher. Be a good husband. Be a good father. Teach your kids Torah and many other instructions. Right next to it, what's the difference? It gets even better. Listen to this. Here. You see a camel here. How do we know which animals are kosher and which animals are not kosher? The Torah says everything that have split hooves and chew is cud, it's kosher. Mafris parsa, shoseh ashesa, that's one sign. Maale gera, chew is cud, chewing a gum, it looks like it. It's the second sign. Two witnesses always. Comes the Torah, comes the Torah and says, be careful. There are four animals in the entire world that can fool you. Be very careful. Why? They have only one sign. Not two. You may think they're kosher, but they're not. Who are they? The camel, the pig, the rabbit, and the hare. Hare, it's almost like a rabbit. Almost the same. Four animals. How many animals we know today to recognize in the archives? How many names? More than 2 million. 2 million names of animals we know. 2 million. When the Torah was given, the Torah promised, from these 2 million animals, four I made unique. All the animals don't have any one of the sign. They don't chew their cud, and they don't have split hooves. They don't have. Some animals, not too many, have two signs. Goats, sheep, cow, giraffe, deer. This is all kosher animals. Giraffe, yes. Why we don't need giraffe? You know why? It would be $100 a pound. You need a ladder every time you want to slaughter it. It's too difficult. So we gave up on giraffe. Time? Time is running out?
No, 1 hour more, 2 hours more, afternoon.
No, we're enjoying it. We're enjoying it.
Finally, we gather together. We have an opportunity to teach the words of God. Okay.
Take your time.
I won't take that much of a time, but I want to just show four or five proofs and we're done. The rest you can watch in a DVD. Okay, now. The Torah says, four animals have only one sign. Which means, if one goy would bring another animal from Zimbabwe, from somewhere, I don't know from where, and he shows, hey, look at this animal. This animal have split hooves in the legs. And it doesn't chew his cud, that will be the end of the Torah. Why? Because the Torah said there are only four exceptional animals. Only four, not five. If somebody would show the fifth kind, that means the Torah made a mistake. Now, do you know a person that knows 2 million different kinds of animals all over the world? Show me one person that was able to write such a thing. Who has a comment to make so far? Any questions so far? Is it clear that everything I show so far is 100% divine?
Yes.
So just before we finish, I want to show you one more thing, very interesting thing. I'm skipping, as you can see. The number of the stars in the world. Until 400 years ago, everybody thought there are 6,000 stars. Why? People used to stand on a mountain and count. When Galileo Galilei brought his telescope, they finally saw there are much more than 6,000 stars. There are many galaxies that we couldn't see. When we look into the oral Torah, the Gemara, not the written Torah, the oral Torah says the exact number in the stars in the world. Do you know a person that 3,300 years ago was able to write the exact number of all the stars in the galaxy when there was not even a telescope? Who would be able to write such a thing? Pay attention. The Torah says, after the destruction of the second temple, the Chachamim came to Hashem and asked him a question. Dear God, a person gets divorced and one day he gets remarried and he will never forget his ex-wife. How could you forget us and leave us like this to die and took away our temple and left us like this? The answer of God to the nation of Israel was as follows. My dear daughter, how God called us? My dear daughter, very nice. 12 sections I created in heaven. Take the entire space, a big circle around Earth, 360 degrees, divided to 12 slices. Each slice is 30 degrees. 360 divided to 12, 30 degrees. 12 section, this is the horoscope. Aries, twins, all these things that we have, all the signs come from the Torah. 12 section I created in heaven. In each section I created 30 army. In each army I created 30 legion. In each legion I created 30 raton. In each raton I created 30 karaton. In each karaton 30 gistera. In each gistera I hung 365,000 stars multiplied by 10,000 stars, and all of that I created for the nation of Israel. And you have the nerve to tell me that I forgot about you and I left you? This is the words of God. Which means, how do you have the nerve to think that I'm God, left you and annulled the agreement that we made in Mount Sinai? How do you think such a thing? Let's calculate together how many stars God said that He created in the world. 12. 12 section, times 30, times 30, 30, 30, 30, times 365,000, times 10,000, it gives us 10 to the power of 19 stars. 1 and 18 digits after. Very, very long now. Quadrillion, I can't even say that number. It's a very, very long number. Let's see what NASA, the scientist, has to say about the number of the stars today. With satellite pictures, and they have mega computer the size of a building in Manhattan. This is the size of their computers, that it count all the pictures that the satellites are taking of all the galaxies, and they never know 100%. But roughly, they tell you the number of the stars in the world. What is it? What is here? In 1990, Dr. T. Brewers from Queen Mary College in London had a research with mega computer and found there are 10 to the power of 19 stars in universe. 10 to the power of 19. And this is how the scientists are calling it. Exactly like the Torah says. God divided that to 7 different categories. One inside the other, and the scientists are also saying 7 different categories. One last thing for tonight, the renewal of the moon. You know that according to the Torah, Pesach has to be in the spring always. Always have to be in the spring, but the Pesach is moving. Because the holiday, the Jews go by the sun and the moon. The sun is 365 days. The year of the sun. The year of the moon is 354 days. 11 days difference. 11 days different. Every 3 years, the holiday moves by a month. So if you ignore the problem, Passover will move from the summer to the winter. But if Pesach will fall in the winter, it's going to be the first mistake in the Torah. Because the Torah called Pesach the holiday of the spring. The Muslims, that they go by the year of the moon, the Ramadan, the fast of the Ramadan, sometimes fall in the summer, sometimes in the winter. Sometimes it's snowing on them, sometimes they're dying in the heat. Why? Because they go by the short year of the moon. Christians that go only by the sun, every 4 years they have February 29. So if you're born on February 29, age 60, you had only 15 birthdays. You lose.
No presents.
But the Jews go by the sun and the moon. Listen to this good, it's beautiful. God said to Moshe, I'm teaching you the math, how to overcome the problem of making a leap year. Every 19 years cycle, we add 7 more months into the Jewish calendar. Adar Aleph, Adar Bet, second Adar. When do we push the extra month into the year? Before Nisan. Nisan is Pesach. Just when we see Nisan is about to fall in a cold weather, we push another month and we postpone it by a month and then it's spring. How did we know to calculate? Listen to this, it's unbelievable. Here is the calculation. The Gemara says 200 witnesses came to Rabban Gamliel 2,000 years ago to tell him that they saw the renewal of the moon. There was no Jewish calendar yet. How did we know when the month began? When the moon renewed, that's the first day of the month. But we need 2 witnesses to come testify. They announce it's Rosh Chodesh, and they begin to count 14 days, and it's Leila Seder. That's how it was, very primitive. 200 witnesses came to the rabbi. They say, Rabbi, we just saw today the renewal of the moon. The rabbi told them, all of you are wrong. 200, not 2, 200. From all over. All of you are wrong. It's cloudy today. You are wrong. Rabbi, you're sitting inside the building. We saw the moon now. You're telling us that we're wrong? The rabbi said, of course. How do I know? When we receive the Torah from God, we pass from generation to generation all the oral laws. The oral Torah. According to the oral law, listen good, you never saw such an amazing thing. According to the oral laws, the renewal of the moon, please don't miss this, please, few more minutes and we're done. The renewal of the moon can never be less than 29 days and a half. 29 days, we all know what it is. What half a day? 12 hours. And 2/3 of the hour, which is 40 minutes. And 73 parts of the minute. All together, it gives us 29, we cannot see it here, but I'll tell you the number. 29.530590.
The hours?
What happened?
They are here, they think they're here for the prayer. Because that they are here, most of us came here for praying for the
Okay, so we finish in 2 minutes.
And they are upset that they're leaving and this didn't happen.
Okay, so we're going to finish in 2 minutes. I didn't know about this, but 2 minutes we're going to finish. Okay, I'll finish this and that's it. So the Torah say 29 days and a half and 2/3 of the hour and 73 parts of the minute, which give us 29.530590. And then NASA, they came with the renewal of the moon, 1/10,000th of a second difference. Take a second, divide it to 10,000 pieces, take one piece out. That's the difference between NASA, what they measure, the renewal of the moon every month, to what the Torah says. The same thing the Germans in 1965 in Berlin. They came with their satellite and their computer to the exact number that the Torah said 3,320 years ago, and there was no calculator, no satellite, no telescope, no way to measure 5 digits after the decimal point. There was no way to do it. Who did it? The creator of the moon, the creator of the sun, the creator of the world, our creator that made an agreement with us. You are my children. I chose you from all the nations to be mine. Now for those who came here to pray today, they have to know one thing that they may not know. The Torah says, this is what God says, it's not my word, so don't get upset at me. I'm just quoting directly from the Torah. המסיר אוזנו משמוע התורה, גם תפילתו תועבה. When someone is not interested to hear the words of my Torah, I'm not interested in his prayers. So you have to know, for God is much more important that Jews would learn Torah, that they will pray to him. If they pray or not, they're still going to have what to eat. It's not going to put them on the street to die. If he wants them to have children, they have children. When the Jews are learning Torah for the health of their brother or sister, it's much more productive than sitting and reading Tehillim, especially when you don't understand the words of the Tehillim. So this is my request to you for the health of the lady that needs our help right now. You can read a million pages, but you have to know God is interested that we're going to listen to him, not only to read like parrots. To listen to him, it's much more important. So now, each one of you, I'm not going to start asking one by one. Please make a commitment to accept one mitzvah for the health of, what was the name again?
Sylvia Leah Bat Turia.
Each one of you accept one mitzvah that you don't do. You choose. Whatever. If you want, you come to me, I'll recommend one. Amen. But you accept this, and Be'ezrat Hashem, with Hashem's mercy, we're going to hear very good news soon, Be'ezrat Hashem.
Amen.
Now we're going to go into the davening, because it's also important to pray. I thank you for sitting so patiently. Thank you very much. Thank you for coming.